Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dean of the Medical Faculty and Chief Executive Officer of Johns Hopkins Medicine, Dr. Paul Rothman.
Good afternoon. Welcome, everyone, and we're so glad you're here to join us here at Johns Hopkins for a very special day. We gather here this afternoon for a really historic day for both Johns Hopkins and for our Sidney Kimmel Cancer Center, and to recognize the immense generosity that animates the work of our extraordinarily talented clinicians, researchers, nurses, students, and staff. The science that we're about to describe today and the extraordinary promise that our expertise in cancer immunology, genetics, and epigenetics hold for beating cancer represents a true partnership and true collaboration that is in the best traditions of Johns Hopkins. To bring this point home, I'd like to introduce a couple individuals in the audience who've really been key to helping us. First, I'd like to introduce three of our trustees, Heather Murin, Brian Rogers, and Sandy Greenberg. Could you wave? We have some of our elected officials here, Governor Larry Hogan, Senator Barbara Mikulski, Senator Ben Cardin, Baltimore City Council President Jack Young, and Baltimore City Health Commissioner Lena Wen. Could you wave? We also have the Johns Hopkins Hospital and Johns Hopkins Health System President and Executive Vice President of Johns Hopkins Medicine, Mr. Ron Peterson. And really, for all of the faculty, staff, the Bloomberg Distinguished Professors, all of whom are here today, welcome and thanks for coming. You know, I'm an immunologist, and we've held the promise of trying to beat cancer by immunology and using our own immune system really for 20 or 30 years, with thought being that if we could turn our own immune system against the cancer, we would have a chance of beating it for long and really curative mechanisms. And it's really been the Johns Hopkins faculty that have struggled for this for 20 to 30 years, trying to understand the basics of why the immune system doesn't beat cancer all the time and how to stimulate it to do that. And it's really the likes of Drew Pardoe, Liz Jaffe, Chuck Drake, Suzanne Tapelian, and Jonathan Powell, who are just a few of the leaders here in our cancer immunology program that have done unbelievably wonderful work moving this field forward. You know, it's a really critical time in cancer immunotherapies. We're having unprecedented success at helping to cure these cancers. And it's at times like this that we're so thankful to have two Johns Hopkins champions who are answering the challenge and providing extraordinary support for our work. Mike Bloomberg, together with Sidney Kimmel, who's helped lay the foundation of our cancer center, are really helping us build for success. Their support is going to be essential for moving this field forward and doing very, very special things. Of course, we have a lot of generous supporters in the room. I want to call out Brian and Mary Jo Rogers, who are in the audience, and Erwin and Stephanie Greenberg. Thank you so much for your support for our cancer center. It's now my distinct privilege to welcome another special guest. I'd like to please join me in welcoming really a champion and a friend of Johns Hopkins, a strong advocate for cancer research and prevention, and the governor of the great state of Maryland, Larry Hogan.
Well, thank you very much. Good afternoon. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here today to congratulate Michael Bloomberg and Sidney Kimmel and everyone involved in making the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg Kimmel Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy a reality. I also want to thank Vice President Biden for joining us today and for his efforts to shine a spotlight on and to be such an incredible advocate for a cure of this terrible disease. Over the past year, I've come to appreciate and understand the work of facilities like this in ways that I could have never imagined. Just 150 days after taking office, I went from being focused on how to turn our state around and to put people back to work, to listening to doctors I'd just met telling me that a very advanced, very aggressive cancer, B-cell non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, had rapidly spread throughout my body. And over the course of 6 months following my diagnosis, I endured aggressive 24-hour-a-day chemotherapy, several surgeries, drug therapies, and immunotherapy, and countless other procedures. And thanks to an incredible team of doctors and nurses and a lot of prayers, I am now 100% cancer-free and in complete remission. But my story is just one of the more than 20,000 Maryland cancer stories each year. And the reality is that cancer has touched nearly every single one of us through family, friends, and loved ones. And over the course of my own treatment, I met so many amazing fellow patients and their families fighting much tougher battles than my own. And it's because of them that as long as I am governor of this great state, and hopefully long after that, I will continue to stand with all of those who are fighting this terrible disease. And that includes proudly supporting Johns Hopkins and the important life-saving work that will be done here at the Bloomberg Kimmel Institute. So once again, I just want to congratulate everyone involved in this incredible effort. And thank you all very much for being here.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Director of Sidney Kimmel Comprehensive Cancer Center, Dr. William Nelson.
Thank you, Governor Hogan. Your experience with cancer has been an inspiration to all Marylanders and everyone throughout the country. And good afternoon to all of you. As you've heard, I'm Bill Nelson, the Marion I. Knott Professor and Director of the Sidney Kimmel Comprehensive Cancer here at Johns Hopkins. And I have to say, all throughout my career here as a clinician and a researcher, and even now as Director of the Kimmel Cancer Center, I cannot recall another time when so many opportunities seem so close, seem within our grasp. This is a testament to the dedicated teams across our cancer center here at Johns Hopkins, to our collaborations throughout the Hopkins University family, 5 Hopkins schools, 33 departments, and to our partnerships with the state of Maryland and its great institutions. In this beautiful rotunda, if you look up, it is kind of round. Don't burn your eyes out. It's just a short walk from a historic rotunda where patient rounds brought students to the bedside to learn. It's my great pleasure to welcome today's Johns Hopkins medical students. As former Hopkins medical students ourselves, Drew Pardoll and I want to thank all of you for joining us as together all of us take a stand against cancer. I know that if Sidney Kimmel were here, he would want to meet all of these students, the Kimmel scholars that he supported, because these students, they are our future. They're the ones who are going to get rid of this dread disease once and for all. For decades, cancer experts have sought this very moment, when the immune system could precisely and predictably be recruited to fight cancer across all cancer types. Much like the cancer cell, the immune cell and system have proven to be very complex, but our experts, whom you'll have a chance to meet this afternoon and who will form the guts of this institute, have demonstrated that they're up to the challenge. The success of immune therapies is real. But the full promise of immune therapy cannot be realized without continued research. 2 years ago, a team of archaeologists announced the discovery of the oldest known case of human cancer in the skeleton of a young man in Egypt who died 3,000 years ago. As you all know, Hippocrates first used the word cancer, which in Greek literally means crab, to describe this family of deadly diseases of runaway cell replication that threatened life itself. Now, finally, we're about to stop this runaway scourge dead in its tracks. With the support of the generous donors Dean Rothman has mentioned, we're now seeing an absolute explosion in cancer research discoveries. Breakthroughs that we have transferred and translated, if you will, to patient care with unprecedented speed. We're also witnessing an amazing technological revolution, and these two trends means we're much better equipped now than ever before to move research that we're going to do in this institute from the bench to the bedside, from the laboratory to the patient for the patient's benefit. And this truly is the Hopkins way. Ask anyone, and they'll tell you that ours is a culture of collaboration, of bumping elbows, of bouncing off ideas. This brings together our best people in teams that collaborate. These teams are committed, unwaveringly and fiercely committed, to turning research into results. I believe that the collaboration here at Johns Hopkins is strong enough to knock down any wall, any silo, so that revolutionary interdisciplinary breakthroughs can occur. As you're about to discover in this short video, finding better ways to help people beat cancer, to take away the disease and give them back their lives, is what today the Johns Hopkins Kimmel Cancer Center and the new Bloomberg Kimmel Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy are all about. Thanks.
It was my husband.
It was my grandfather.
My uncle.
My grandpa.
For me, it was my 7-year-old daughter.
My uncle.
My cousin.
My grandmother.
It was me. I was the one that had the cancer. I was diagnosed in April of 2008. I had two surgeries, radiation, chemotherapy. Cancer was just growing. They had nothing left for me. So basically, what I'm hearing is, I'm done, I'm through.
It seems like everyone is touched in some way by cancer. In Mr. Gobin's case, he had exhausted other types of therapy, but now we have another pillar of treatment called immunotherapy.
Immunotherapy is a very different kind of cancer therapy, specifically helping to unleash the patient's own immune system to really do the work and to attack their cancer.
So the idea behind modern immunotherapy is that there are cells in your body, the CD8 T cells, that are designed to kill other cells. The exciting recent discovery is the finding that there's a molecule called PD-1 on immune cells. The normal role of PD-1 is to prevent the immune system from getting out of hand and accidentally damage your normal tissue. What's happened is tumors have figured out how to push this button, how to turn the T cells off. They do that by expressing the molecule called PD-L1.
Now the cancer is putting up these proteins that say stop. And so we need to come in with an antibody that inhibit them from interacting fully, allowing the immune cells that have come in to now kill the cancer.
And if you block that interaction, in some patients, you get these beautiful responses where the immune system can kill the tumor cell.
So Mr. Gobin decided he wanted to be on a trial of a checkpoint inhibitor called the PD-1 antibody. By 8 weeks, we were able to detect that his cancer had started shrinking, and then within 6 months, we were unable to tell that he even had cancer.
It was 3 years and 3 months ago. Since then, it's not grown, it's not spread. So I get a funny feeling I'm going to be here for a long time.
What gets me up every morning is trying to make a difference for my patients. And now we actually have therapy that can work for a long period of time. It's just an amazing experience.
I think I actually tend to dwell on the patients for whom we haven't made an impact. And I tend to think about what we can do for those patients. But, you know, if you had to list the cancers that immune therapy will have an impact in the next 5 to 10 years, I think it's frankly all of them.
For the first time, I think the possibilities are really limitless.
We've mined 5%, but we see that there's 95% that is now within reach. And the Bloomberg Kimmel Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy is going to step our efforts up by a quantum leap.
Immunotherapy is the cutting edge of cancer medicine,
And I, along with the other cancer patients and survivors, have waited more than 20 years to see this day arrive. And what fabulous partners. Bill Nelson, Paul Rothman, all the docs, Ron Daniels, and of course, a person of unparalleled leadership, Mike Bloomberg, with whom I am particularly proud to share this moment. It's an amazing team, and I'm humbled to be among them.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Johns Hopkins University President Ronald Daniels, Johns Hopkins alumnus and three-term New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg, and the Vice President of the United States of America, Joe Biden.
Well, good afternoon, and thank you, Paul and Bill. This is truly a momentous day for Johns Hopkins and for all of us who are dedicated to this cause of defeating cancer. Mr. Vice President, know how grateful we are for the remarkable, indomitable spirit which you've responded to your own loss and galvanized the nation around our shared commitment to ending this disease. Thank you so very much. Governor Hogan, thank you for the candor and the courage you have shown in sharing your experiences with those you serve. 45 years ago, President Nixon declared war on cancer. In the ensuing decades, the metaphor took hold and morphed into descriptions of targeted skirmishes and epic battles. It shaped policy and weighed heavily on patients, families, and physicians asked to fight the disease, very often with blunt, crude weapons. But in the metaphor of war, the lines of battle are drawn between enemy combatants. It is bloody, it is brutal, it is focused on conquering the other. And it fails to capture the devastating, essential truth about this disease. Cancer is of us. We know now that this war on cancer metaphor, like our current treatments, has only taken us so far. Today, we celebrate our ability not to marshal outside agents to beat back a foe, but instead to harness the unmatched brilliance of the body's own internal defense, the immune system, to seek out and eradicate the disease. And with that new approach, a different metaphor is taking hold, the moonshot. The moonshot speaks to a wholly different paradigm. It recognizes that marshaling brute force does not alone generate success. It recognizes that we have aggressively exploited existing therapies, but to cover the enormous margin still before us requires altogether different, novel thinking. Instead of a call to arms, it is a call to ideas, a call to build on science, on acts of individual imagination, of inspiration, of intellectual risk-taking to deepen our knowledge and change markedly clinical outcomes. And here is where the American academic medical community, and Johns Hopkins in particular, excel. At Johns Hopkins, America's first research university, individual academic capability is sedulously cultivated and nurtured. The freedom to dream, to think, to act anew is deeply embedded. Innovation and cross-disciplinary collaboration are part of our DNA. Thanks to that unique amalgam, we have arrived at this very important moment in the history of cancer. It was here that Hopkins researchers Drew Pardoll and Suzanne Topolian staked their lives and their science on the unorthodox idea of immunotherapy. It was here that they and their amazing colleagues found an academic home when funding for such unorthodox ideas was hard to find and skepticism reigned
in the scientific establishment. It was here that our clinician scientists proved the power of anti-PD-1 protocols to impact not only melanoma and lung cancer, but many other cancers. And it is here that the Sidney Kimmel Cancer Center was created and the immunology program begun, uniting oncologists, immunologists, and pathologists in common cause, and bringing to bear the insights of physicians with physicists and computer scientists, and the power of big data science to tailor treatments to individuals. So today, it is with soaring anticipation that we answer a new call, our moonshot moment with the launch of the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg Kimmel Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy. Of course, Mike Bloomberg and Sidney Kimmel are not known for being swayed by grand metaphor. They don't invest in hyperbole, though God knows I've tried to persuade them to do such that. They look for and rightly demand that ideas are backed by solid research and reams of data matched and galvanized by inspired talent. In short, they don't bet on a moonshot moment unless they can already envision a clear vector to the moon. In this case, we are the great beneficiary and have been for many years of their generosity, their vision, and their impeccable eye for the next big idea and the talent required to realize it. Mike and Sidney, your commitment secures our margin of excellence as we build on a strong foundation of public support to turn this aspirational moonshot metaphor into a reality, and for this, we are truly grateful. To our patients, families, scientists, and clinicians, thank you for your commitment, your fearlessness, and your work leading us forward. And Vice President Biden, thank you for your leadership and inspiration. Together, we will harness the innate brilliance of the human body, the determination of patients and families, and the imagination of our scientists and clinicians to chart a course to cancer's ultimate end. And I say this as one of the few non-scientists in the room, mark my words. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm David Gobin. I'm an 8-year cancer survivor, thanks to you. That is 8 years that I've had with my family and friends, all because of you and the incredible doctors, nurses, and scientists here at Johns Hopkins. I shouldn't embarrass myself twice, thank you. To all of you here today, I just want to say thanks. Thank you for giving me a second chance at life. I want to give special thanks to two people in particular, the co-founders of this remarkable new institute, Mr. Sidney Kimmel and Mr. Michael Bloomberg. It's now my great honor to introduce a true advocate for so many patients and their families, the three-term New York City mayor and Johns Hopkins' own Mr. Michael Bloomberg. The pleasure is so much fun, you can't believe it.
David, thank you for sharing your story and for your service to Baltimore. If Joe and I both want to take some speaking lessons from you, we certainly know how to do it. Your story really is so inspiring that we're here to make sure that others have the same chance to beat cancer just as you have. And I did want to thank Governor Hogan for being here with us, but particularly Senators Mikulski and Ben Cardin. They have been phenomenal for this country. They've been great for Baltimore, but most importantly, they've really stood up to Johns Hopkins as long as they've both been in office. Barbara, Senator, and Ben, first as a congressman and then senator. Barbara, as Henry Kissinger would have said, it had the added advantage of being true. And it is an honor to have Vice President Biden with us today and to join many people from Johns Hopkins that are really doing incredible work to advance cancer treatment and save lives. And every one of us, I know, at some point in our lives is touched by cancer, whether it affects our own health or that of a friend or of a loved one. And I don't know a single person that hasn't lost someone they care about to cancer or seen someone they love struggle to fight it. And too many of them, tragically, are young men and women who are full of so much progress. And I know a lot of you who knew Joe Biden's son, Beau, were heartbroken when he passed away last year after his battle with brain cancer. I knew Beau casually. We played golf together, much better golfer than I was. Better golfer than his father, I will also say that, Joe. Sorry. And he did a great job for his state. The country lost a young leader with the kind of selflessness and integrity that all of us hope that we have as public servants. And the Biden family lost someone who showed the kind of decency and honesty and love that all of us hope are in our children. Values that were instilled in him by a father who taught him what it meant to be a great citizen and even more importantly, to be a great parent. I can't imagine what it must be like to lose a child. It's something that no parent should ever have to experience. But the Vice President is determined to turn that tragedy for his family into a positive for other families, and we're glad to stand with him. The work that Joe is leading now will help save so many lives and spare other parents from suffering the pain that the Biden family has felt. And Joe, I have no doubt that Beau is smiling down on you today, proud that your last big crusade in public office, unless you're going to tell me something that we don't know. We actually talked about doing a joint ticket, but we couldn't agree on whether it was reverse or straight alphabetical order. Seriously, though, this may be your most powerful and important legacy for all of your service to this country. When President Obama announced the new push to end cancer during his State of the Union address, he called it a moonshot, and I think that is fitting. Like the effort to put a human on the moon, ending cancer is a dream that we've all long held. And today, thanks to advances in technology, it is within our reach for the very first time. And if we succeed, it will really be another great leap forward for mankind. I'm optimistic that we can do it. Cancer detection and treatment are advancing every day. We now have the ability to cure cases of cancer that might have been hopeless even just a few short years ago. And there really is a real sense among doctors and scientists that we're on the brink of major breakthroughs. And one of the reasons for that is the field of immunotherapy. Immunotherapy is a groundbreaking treatment that allows the body to use its own immune system rather than poisonous drugs to fight cancer. And it's the closest thing that we've got to a natural treatment, and it's the most promising avenue of research today in the field. In fact, because of its versatility, it has the potential to cure and end virtually all kinds of cancer. Now, that may sound far-fetched or futuristic, but it's not. The results from some of the latest immunotherapy trials have been nothing short of astounding. We still obviously have a long ways to go. We're always going to have a long ways to go in medicine, and a cure won't come overnight, but I think there's never been more reason to hope that we have turned a corner and a cure is now in sight. And it is no surprise that Johns Hopkins University has been a pioneer in the field of immunotherapy. This was America's first research university, and the school remains an engine for innovation, particularly in health and medicine. I've had the honor of chairing the school's board, and I saw firsthand how the hospital and the School of Public Health changed people's lives. That experience inspired my passion for public health, and it's why I've continued to be such a strong supporter of this university. Our foundation, Bloomberg Philanthropies, has teamed up with Hopkins on everything from tobacco control and road safety to stopping gun violence, to stop mosquitoes from spreading malaria. So when we wanted to tackle cancer, we knew there was no better partner than Johns Hopkins. And a lot of this credit goes to Ron Daniels, the great president of this university. His enthusiasm, yes, he deserves a round of applause. His enthusiasm for cutting-edge medical research and his willingness to push the envelope really are contagious. Ron has done a fantastic job guiding Hopkins and focusing its resources where they can make the biggest difference. And that includes the work that will be done here at this new institute. So I'm excited to support it with our co-founder, Sidney Kimmel. Sidney, as you know, has made cancer his mission, and he has been extremely generous. It's been inspiring to see what he's helped make possible, including some of the first clinical trials on immunotherapy, which took place here at Johns Hopkins at the Kimmel Comprehensive Cancer Center. And so I want to thank him for his leadership and for making today possible. Although, in all fairness, he would agree with me, it's pretty hard to say no to Ron Daniels when he gets the bit in his teeth. Nevertheless, I want to give a big thanks to two people who will be helping to lead this institute's work, Dr. Bill Nelson and Dr. Drew Pardoll. I'm a big believer, as you know, in public-private partnerships to fuel innovation and support great new ideas, and I'm looking forward to see what we can achieve here. Unlike the first moonshot, which was government-sponsored initiative, this moonshot is a true partnership between government, the private sector, and philanthropic organizations. And if we're half as successful, and I believe that we will be, we're going to make an enormous difference in the future of the world. To end all cancers would rank among humanity's greatest achievements, and every step forward will save lives and keep families together. We're lucky to have Vice President Biden leading the charge. I've been fortunate to work with him on a number of issues over the years, including gun safety. And whether it's guns or any other tough issue, Joe Biden knows how to bring people together, and he's doing the same for the fight against cancer. So I want to thank him personally. Joe, you are the greatest. Thank you for inspiring and leading this effort. And to commemorate your visit today, we've dedicated a bench to you here on Johns Hopkins campus, and we have a photo right there. It's not much, but that's all we're going to do. Seriously, the plaque on it honors the Vice President for his leadership that he has shown in eradicating cancer. And it includes a quote from Helen Keller that I think sums up the spirit behind this effort. It reads, quote, "No pessimist ever discovered the secret of the stars," unquote. And I know it's that spirit that has always guided Joe's work and that has guided his son's, Beau's service to our country. And I hope that the generations of students and professors and visitors who stop to rest and reflect on that bench will see it each time they pass by and will be inspired to follow in their footsteps and reach for the stars. Mr. Vice President, would you honor us with saying a few words?
My name is Joe Biden, and I work for Barbara Mikulski. Governor Hogan, I got a chance to speak to you before, but I can't tell you how excited we are about your battle and how well you're doing. You understand it more than most people. And Ben, you can sit on my bench anytime you want. It's great to be with you, Ben, and my friend, Mayor Bloomberg. And Ron, thank you very much. And Bill, we got a chance to spend some time together before, and I'm happy to do it again. I need not tell anyone assembled in this hall that this is personal for so many of us that are in this hall, and the millions of Americans who face that dreaded phrase, "I'm afraid you have cancer." And as I said, Governor, no one understands it more than you. And Mr. Mayor, I have had the privilege of working in a number of things. And the one thing about Mike is, everything Mike does is he prides himself on not being emotional, but it all comes from the heart. But it's always data driven. It's always about finding an answer. It's always about the sense that and the belief that there is an answer, whether it's a senseless gun violence that goes on in this country, whether it is we could do more to prevent cancer by eliminating tobacco use than anything else we could do. Whatever you're engaged in, Mike, it's always been something that's been not about you. It's about something bigger. And it's always organized. It's always committed. And everything Mike has done has been consequential. And that's why it's so significant that that the mayor is helping lead this effort to perfect immunotherapies that have the potential to literally end cancer as you know it. And look around at all these young people in the white coats. You're going to be reading about some of them. Not a joke. They're about to be part of making history. Their generation, not a joke, is literally, not figuratively, going to change the face of humanity. The progress that we are going to make over the next 10 years will eclipse everything that's happened over the previous 50 years, maybe longer. And these are the folks that are going to be in the cutting edge of it all. And I say, you know, Mike says he only talks about the medical school. All you got to do is say foreign policy is SICE. All you got to do is say anything. Everything is about Johns Hopkins. I learned that this is the place where everything from cookies were first baked to bridges were first built. I didn't know. I didn't know everything began at Hopkins. I knew it was a great institution, but I didn't know everything. Everything. Ask Mike a question, and he'll tell you can find an answer at Hopkins. And, but, talk about a loyal guy, and all that the Kimmel Foundation has done, all that Stanley Kimmel has done has been astounding. It's not just here. So many other endeavors I've observed where he is engaged, he has put his money where his mouth is, and he has worked so hard to change the circumstances for literally millions of people. 16 million a year die of this disease. And so, folks, I want to very quickly talk about the moonshot. You know, when I decided not to run for president and the president escorted me out to the Rose Garden, where I made that announcement, I said, not with any plan in mind, I said, the one regret I have about not running, I would have liked to have been the president to preside over the end of cancer as we know it in this country. Because I learned a lot, as all of you have, who have not had cancer, but your loved ones have. I learned when my son was diagnosed at MD Anderson with stage 4 glioblastoma, that it was a death sentence. I understood that. I did my homework. I've spent a lot of time trying to learn as much as I possibly could learn. All of those of you who have family members who you've lost to or fighting cancer, you know what I mean. And I had access to learn a lot. And what amazed me was not only what we didn't know, but how much we knew in such a recent past. 5 years ago, immunology was sort of out there. 10 years ago, it was clearly this voodoo science that, and I'm not joking, am I? I mean, you know, the scientific community treated it like a lot of you guys treat, high-frequency ultrasound now, but we'll get into that another day. But all kidding aside, shortly thereafter, to my surprise, the president announced at the State of the Union that he was going to put me in charge of an effort to focus the federal government's effort in collaboration with the private sector in doing what we're not naive. We don't think we're going to find a cure to every cancer right away. But I firmly believe we can do in the next 5 years with focus what would have taken 10 to 15 years. That will change dramatically, the life of millions of people around the world. And what the president did is, as my two colleagues will know, when he put together the Recovery Act, he put me in charge of it. And the great thing about working with the president is that's it. I never have to report. I just can go do what has to be done. Well, what he did was he put out a memorandum to all federal agencies, Health and Human Services, the National Institute of Health, the National Cancer Institute, the National Science Foundation, the Department of Defense, the Department of Commerce, the Energy Department, the Department of Veterans Affairs, who runs the largest hospital in the world, the White House Office of Management and Budget, the National Council of Economic Advisors, the Domestic Policy Council, and the Office of Science and Technology. The reason I read those off is some of those institutions, you may wonder, what do they have to do with dealing with the fight against cancer? And I've called a cabinet meeting, two so far, and laid out an agenda for them. I ask each of the cabinet secretaries to be guided by a few recommendations that are initially out of the box. One, accelerate the understanding of cancer. That sounds so simple. To deal with early detection, treatment, and cures. Improve patient access to care. We know that 75% of the cancer patients are treated by community oncologists. 95% never get into any of these studied programs to determine whether or not they would qualify or to be part of determining how to deal with their cancers. And they're not associated with major cancer centers. And we want to make sure that the patients receive the best care, all patients. That's one of the areas that you've been working on here at the Sidney Kimmel Cancer Institute for a long time. The third thing was identify existing regulatory barriers that exist at the federal level that are an impediment to improving patient care. I promise you, as my colleagues will tell you, and it's not a joke, I'll make sure those barriers are taken away. That's a guarantee. There is no question about it. But so as I go around to all the major cancer institutions, I ask them, what are the federal impediments? We talked about it, Doc. What can we do better at the federal government? And four, I said, we got to provide greater access to research that's already been done, data that's already presently available, as well as emerging data and information. And so one of the big questions is, how do we unlock that data? We had a brief discussion about it before we came out. Here's why it matters. Researchers are essentially looking for new patterns of treatment. As the president told me, you've engaged an astronomer, who I will not mention right now, who has been engaged now in determining, just like patterns in the sky and the stars, it can't be seen by the naked eye. What are the patterns? What are the patterns that emerge in cancer? Because cancer changes from the time, in fact, you detect in a cancer cell what the components of the genetic makeup of that is, by the time it's red, the cancer will have changed again, And so cancer researchers get an enormous amount of help finding those patterns if we take advantage of the place we find ourselves now that didn't exist even 10 years ago. We can now do 1,000 billion calculations per second on a computer, 1,000 billion per second. Speaking with the Department of Energy and Ernie Moniz, one of the brightest guys I've ever met from MIT, we're on the verge of being able to compute 1 billion calculations per second. These supercomputers can analyze large amounts of data, uncover hidden patterns that they wouldn't have found otherwise in a short amount of time. They can look through the data that once took years. Why is a particular treatment or a drug effective in 10% of the patients with what is initially identified as the same cancer? Why, for 90% of those patients with the same cancer, it generates no positive impact? These are patterns that you have to examine, that if you take it as an individual or a group of scientists, you're talking about potentially years to identify. You know, a doc in Hagerstown treating a cancer patient who doesn't have access to the data that already exists, the information that's already developed here at Hopkins, or someone in Scranton, Pennsylvania doesn't have access to what's ever at the Abramson Cancer Institute of Penn, has difficulty determining how to treat his or her patient. But if he or she is able to tap into the data and experience of the docs and researchers here at Hopkins, they have a much, much better chance of prescribing the best treatment for that particular patient. Not a guarantee, but a real chance that doesn't exist otherwise. As one top cancer researcher told me, we have to allow the data to actually yield answers. We have to allow the data to actually yield answers. That can be fully within our power. As I said, power we didn't have 15 years ago. Now we have the tools to help solve the puzzle. As I said, the computing capability is astounding, astounding. So, ladies and gentlemen, we're in a situation before too long, when we get to a billion, billion calculations a second, it increases exponentially the opportunity to identify the patterns and the way cancer works. We need to optimize federal investments to improve incentives for public-private partnerships, which Michael is so good at setting up, to accelerate this project. That's exactly what the mayor and Sidney Kimmel have done with their incredibly generous grant. I don't want to leave the impression that the federal government's the answer. It's not. But, or that the Moonshot Initiative will be solely a federal government-focused operation. The National Institute of Health, the National Cancer Institute, have been significant value added, and they'll continue to be so. But we can make them much better if we do it right. My job is to make this public-private partnership seamless. But ultimately, the bulk of the answers are going to come from these brilliant folks in the white coats and all of you here who have already done so much, where the vast majority of expertise exists. That's why for the past 4 months, I've traveled the country and the world listening on a listening tour, touching every serious nerve center for the fight against cancer, both home and abroad. To briefly summarize, just in the past few months, I've heard from thousands of cancer survivors, over 220 leading oncologists, researchers, a half a dozen Nobel laureates from such diverse fields as chemical engineering, data science, immunology, virology. I've traveled to the leading cancer centers, the Abramson Cancer Institute at the University of Pennsylvania, the University of Texas, MD Anderson, Duke University Cancer Center, Nant Health in Los Angeles, led by Dr. Patrick Shenshun. I toured the Huntsman Institute at the University of Utah, watched what they have done, particularly using the Utah population data and how much progress they have made. I visited the University of California in San Francisco, where they're applying personalized medicine in the fight against cancer. And last week, the Fred Hutchinson Foundation in Seattle, where they pioneered bone marrow transplant, are now integrating databases that will analyze, sort, and compare data from patients at several institutions. And I met with dozens of philanthropists and who've invested billions of dollars of their own in the aggregate for research to bring quality care to patients. I met with coalitions of cancer organizations that are aggregating data into machine-readable format. Orion, Cancer Link, Project Genie, Quilt Coalition. They're spending over $1 billion. Imagine if they're all coordinating so that all of it would be accessible to everyone. I met with a number of data technology firms that are aggregating data into machine-readable formats. You all understand that better than anyone in the audience. So it'll be accessible to cancer researchers and clinicians. And my staff has met with dozens of other organizations and philanthropies. After all the meetings I've had, there's agreement on several things, the most important of which is we really, literally, not figuratively, are at an inflection point in our battle against this dreaded disease. As I said, when my son was diagnosed 3 years ago, I tried to learn all that I could learn about treatments and prospects. I was surprised to learn that only in the past 4 or 5 years have oncologists begun working with immunologists, virologists, molecular biologists, and so many other disciplines. I didn't know that it was so new. For the previous 40 years, it was find the tumor, excise as much as you can, find as precisely targeted radiation as you can, and then chemotherapy as targeted as you can, without, up to that point, realizing that you kill as much of the immune system as you do the cancer sometimes. If we can harness this moment, I believe we can make quantum leaps in ending cancer as we know it. And one of the most promising developments in immunotherapy, which has emerged as one of the major hopes in the fight against cancer. And again, 10 years ago, no one took it — I shouldn't say no one — few people took it seriously. Last week, the cover of Time magazine asked, what if your immune system could be taught to kill cancer? Think about it. 2016, and the question is being asked for the first time in a major publication, a popular publication. What if your immune system? Folks, it's been a long time in coming, but it is an inflection point. That's exactly what's happening here. Because of the work of brilliant researchers like Dr. Pardo, who leads an incredible institute, the Bloomberg Kimmel Institute for Immunology, along with his team. Here's why it's important. Cancer, as you all know in here, but for the public listening and the cameramen and women and the reporters out there, cancer involves the uncontrolled growth of our cells. Cancer cells co-opt the process of normal cells, using them to grow, to spread, and to cloak themselves from detection from our own immune system. Everyone in here who works in this field knows that. But the public at large, one of the things I'm trying to do, Michael, in this last 4 months and the next 6 months is translate this into plain English so the American public understands what we're doing. The doctor and his team did some of the first clinical trials on immunotherapy agents known as checkpoint blockade inhibitors. Translated to English, they're the things that disrupt molecules that shield tumor cells and make it possible to redirect the patient's individual immune system to direct, target, and destroy cancer cells. You hear talk here about anti-PD-1. It was here. Just like the immune system targets viruses or bacteria. Immunotherapies have already helped transform the types of cancer, some types of cancer, into chronic, manageable diseases, where 10 years ago, they were a virtual death sentence. We have one beautiful woman here who can attest to that. Over the next 10 years, hopefully 5 in my view, because of this generous $125 million gift, this institute is going to perfect new therapies and help bring hope to millions of patients and their families. This is a great example of one of the core elements of the Cancer Moonshot Task Force, facilitating cooperation between government, the private sector, academia, and philanthropy. I know you work closely with the National Institute of Health and National Cancer Institute. And whenever the government is a bureaucratic stumbling block, I promise you, let me know about it. We will clear the stumbling block. This institute can be a model for how the public-private partnership can drive progress. And I have no doubt this will be the site of some of the next generation's breakthroughs in cancer treatments. I've seen it all across America, some of the best research centers in the world. And thanks to the generosity of Mayor Bloomberg and Sidney Kimmel, that progress is not only going to continue here. It'll be accelerated here. We're in a place where science and medicine have not been before. And it's offering immense, immense hope if we can get out of our own way. If we can get out of our own way and share more of this data. We can harness this moment and make quantum leaps toward ending cancer as we know it. And I truly believe that. That's because I'm no expert. like the President of the University, I'm one of the non-scientists in here. But I spent over 1,000 hours trying to get my arms around how we should proceed. There's a lot of open questions. Most of you probably think that patients own their own data. If they have a biopsy of their tumor, they own it. No. No, no. They don't. Most places. Most of you think that if you have, there's a common language for how to determine what your healthcare records say. In the Human Genome Project, there was a common language, essentially an alphabet determined. You all speak the same language when you're talking about genomics. But the President and I, with the help of my two colleagues in the Recovery Act, we not only wanted to save us from a depression, we wanted to change the way we govern. So we put in $35 billion for electronic record keeping. The President and I, no experts, we sought the experts, only to find out we've created stovepipes within institutions. 4 or 5 major outfits. I will not mention them. We were talking about here at Hopkins, or at Penn, or at MD Anderson, or at Jeff, all the places my son was. When he was in a study of one with anti-PD-1 at the same time opening his head shooting a virus into the tumor, all we wanted to do was make sure when he was up here that the 4 or 5 times a day they would do a make sure that they checked out exactly what progress was being made through the MRI, we couldn't get the information down to MD Anderson because they had different systems. Think about it. And I, although I am listed as the poorest man in the Senate, I have great access as Vice President. But because I had a son-in-law as one of the leading surgeons in the Philadelphia area, he was able to go around and individually collect the data, get on a plane, and fly it down to Anderson. This is 2016. Try it. Try to get your medical records. Try to find out, even from your local physician, to go get your MRI, to then go to a specialist. You get charged about $3 per page. You have to physically pick it up. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. The generic point I'm making is, so much of the brilliance that's in this room is being impeded by very practical roadblocks that we ought to be able to clear out of the way. And when we do, the progress, Doc, you're one of the best in the nation. The progress you and your team will make, I believe, will increase exponentially. One last point, as my two colleagues can tell you, and I need not, probably even make the statement. Our government is not particularly functional right now. There's not much that's bipartisan. But I've gotten overwhelming bipartisan support from the House and the Senate. I predict we will add another $1 billion to cancer research this year. It's the one thing that there's overwhelming domestic consensus about, crossing party lines. And Michael, one of the reasons why I think what you're doing is so important, and I really mean this, and you and I have talked briefly about this. I don't know how we got to this point in America where we've sort of lost the sense that anything and everything is possible in America. I was with President Xi. I've spent more time with him than any world leader. 24 or 25 hours of private dinners, I'm told. They keep count of these things. And I was in Chengdu, a town that was 2 million, now 20 million. And he looked at me and he said, Mr. Vice President, can you define America for me? I said, yeah, I can. In one word, and I mean it. Possibilities. Possibilities. It's the uniqueness of who we are. We have never wondered whether or not if we brought all the resources available in this country together that there's a problem we're unable to solve. And I'm convinced, because of the work of all of you and the progress you'll make on cancer, we will reinstill in the American public the notion that anything is possible. We are so much better situated than any other nation in the world to lead the world in the 21st century. That's not hyperbole. It's just a fact. Remember making a speech at the Wharton School in 1997, debating a professor about why Japan wasn't going to own America. Remember those days? Japan was going to own America. Remember we weren't going to be able to compete with the EU, 380 million people? Remember we were told how China was going to eat our lunch? Give me a break. We want them all to do well. The better they do, the better we'll do. But ladies and gentlemen, there's so much on the horizon. And I'm convinced not only will we save millions of lives, we'll begin to once again reinstill in the American public the attitude, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart, that anything is possible. Not because of Barack Obama and Joe Biden, whoever the next president is going to be. We have the finest research universities in the world. No other country in the world is organized as we are. None. No other country in the world. The brilliance that flows from these institutions. So, folks, there's not much we can't do. We got to start holding our heads up, talking about who we are, what's capable. And you students are going to see more, you professors, you docs, are going to see more happen in the next 15 years than happened in the last 75 years, not just in cancer. You're going to be flying subsonically at 20,000 miles an hour. You're going to be in a vacuum tube going 800 miles an hour. Not a joke. Not a joke. Not a joke. There's so many things on the horizon. So we're looking to you, Doc. We're looking to this institution and other great institutions to lead the way, because once we deal with this, there's so much more we can do. Thank you for your scholarship. Thank you for your brilliance. Thank you for your dedication. And thank you for your willingness to put the interest of other people ahead of your own. To all the physicians, researchers, and staff, the breakthrough you will make in the next 5 years can literally change the face of the world. And it's because of all that you've already done, and because of guys like Mike, who have done so well, but don't forget what the overall obligation we all have is, that are transforming this whole operation. Mike, we owe you and Sidney a whole lot. There's a whole generation of people who might not know why they're alive, but it'll be in part because of what you did. Thank you all so much. Thank you.
So it's my job to thank the Vice President for his inspiration and telling us about possibilities, to thank Michael Bloomberg and Sidney Kimmel for turning possibilities into realities, to thank all of you for coming, and please remind you to stay put, stay seated. For security reasons, the Vice President's going to take a route out of here, and then afterwards we'll have a wonderful reception. So thank you all very much for coming.